So welcome everyone for this series that IIB Chennai chapter has started, BABOK 3 Demystified. This is a webinar series that will continue throughout 2016, and this is first in the series. My name is Surendra Saxena, and I am the co-founder and managing director of Velicate Technologies. Velicate Technologies is an endorsed education provider of EEP. It is a recognized training provider of IRAB and also an REP, global REP of PMI. We are focused on business analysis, project program management, process management, agile, and leadership development. And it's absolute pleasure to interact with you on this. Before I go, I need to also mention about IIB Chennai chapter. Many of you know that IIB Chennai chapter was awarded the best chapter from IIBA in the region 3. And this year we have over 18 good webinars coming. So please stay tuned, go to the website of IIB Chennai and look at those events that are planned, and you know, attend them. I'm sure you will like them. This webinar, as I was saying, it is first in the series. It is always actually very tricky for business analysts to work in agile environment, and therefore there are a lot of things that we are going to discuss over here. So please bear with me. There could be a shortage of time and we might overrun by up to 10 minutes, right? So let's see how much we can cover. But in case we are not able to cover all your questions, please feel free to ask me those questions. My email ID and phone number is on your screen. So you can note that email address. This webinar is being recorded, and it will be put on the YouTube channel of IIB Chennai chapter, so you can also watch this webinar later. Okay, so once again, welcome to all of you, and let's get started. So what we are going to cover is we are going to demystify the BABOK 3. So I will actually explain what is BABOK 3 all about, right? And then we will learn what do you mean by perspective. What is that perspective? Okay. And then we will, at very high level, know what is Agile. Many of you might be knowing Agile, but still actually we will spend some time understanding what are the basic principles of Agile. And then, you know, perspective, Agile, and then what is Agile perspective, right? And what is the life of a business analyst on Agile projects? So what is business analysis in Agile? And ultimately, at the end, we will have enough time for question and answer. Whenever you have a question, you can type in the chat window, at the end I will go through all those questions and then we'll answer those questions. Okay, so that's what it is actually. So first of all, let us demystify BABOK 3. Okay, what is different between BABOK 3 and BABOK 2? So BABOK 2, this is the definition of business analysis from the perspective of BABOK version 2. Business analysis is a set of tasks and techniques used to work as a liaison among stakeholders in order to understand the structure, policies, and operations of an organization and to recommend solutions that enable the organization to achieve its goal. So it talks about the activities, the tasks, and the techniques that business analysts used to perform those tasks. And those tasks will ultimately actually help the organization achieve the goal. So the focus is on business analysts. Focus on the tasks and techniques that the business analysts need to perform. Focus on how well these tasks and techniques can be performed. And where exactly, in what circumstances, which tasks need to be performed, what technique is most appropriate over there. So the focus was complete on the business analysis task. Okay, and here is the definition that is coming from BABOK 3.0. Business analysis is the practice of enabling change in an enterprise by defining the needs and recommendations that deliver the value to the stakeholders. Business analysis enables an enterprise to articulate needs and rationale for those changes and to design and describe the solutions that can deliver value, right? So the definition actually has drastically changed, and therefore that reflects the focus that IIBA has on supporting the businesses, and that is driven by the businesses actually. So when BABOK 3 got developed, BABOK 3 had several volunteers from the industry, and they reflected actually, they shared what the industry needs, and that is reflected in version 3. So let's take a closer look at the differences. Okay, so the first one you see in the blue, actually the business analysis is a set of tasks and techniques, right? That was the theme in version 2. And what has become in version 3, it is now a practice of enabling change, right? So the focus is the organization now, actually you're enabling the change. It is a practice of enabling the change. It is more than the set of tasks and techniques. Of course, the BABOK 3 also had tasks and techniques, but those techniques are used as a tool to enable that practice of enable the change in an organization, right? The other thing was BABOK 2 talked about recommending solutions that enable the organization to achieve its goal. And what BABOK 3 is talking about, recommending solutions, so definitely recommending solutions, however, that will deliver the value to the stakeholders. Okay, the value to the stakeholders. And stakeholders are within the organization. Stakeholders are outside the organization as well, right? These are your customers, these are your suppliers, these are the regulatory bodies, these are standard bodies. So recommending those solutions that deliver the values to the customers, right? An entire thing, business analysis enables an enterprise to articulate the needs. So they basically, business analysts play an important role for the organization to recognize what the business needs are and be able to articulate those needs and the rationale for the change, why this change is necessary, what is the rationale for change. And also it goes a step beyond, design and describe the solution, what the solution should be, okay, that can deliver that value. So what could be the features and functions of that solution, how that solution will look like actually, that will deliver to the value to the organization. So see, the definition has changed, and now actually business analyst role is even more powerful, more meaningful than it was before in BABOK 2. So let's see how the IIBA BABOK enables the business analyst deliver to these expectations, right? So before I move forward, let us read this definition once again and understand that definition, because everything in BABOK is now related to this, enabling you as professionals to deliver this. So business analysis is the practice of enabling change in an enterprise by defining the needs and recommending solutions that deliver the value to the stakeholders. Okay, business analysis enables an enterprise to articulate needs and the rationale for change and to design and describe solutions that can deliver the value. Okay, so it is all about, you know, recommending solutions that will, that are valuable to stakeholders, and also designing and describing the solutions that will deliver that value. So let's see, how the IIBA has changed is the structure of its BABOK to meet this new, much enhanced role of a business analyst. So this was the structure of BABOK 2.0, which is on your screen. There were these six knowledge areas and underlying competencies, right? So these knowledge areas were enterprise analysis, which is all about actually identifying the business need, identifying what are the gaps in the capabilities in the organization to meet those business needs, identifying the possible solutions, alternate solutions, recommending the best solution, and also developing the business case, right? So that was the enterprise analysis. And for that business need, assessing the solutions actually. So making an assessment of every solution, solution option, and recommending the best, validating that solution, how well that solution meets the business need. So assessing those solutions and recommending the best solution, and also validating that solution when the solution is there actually. So enterprise analysis could have the business need could be met through the solutions which are already there in the market, and therefore there was an arrow which was going up from here to the solution assessment and validation. And sometimes you need to construct your own solution, you need to develop that solution, and if the solution needs to be developed, then you actually analyze the requirements. So requirements analysis was the knowledge area which was all about actually prioritizing those requirements, analyzing, detailing, modeling those requirements, you know, verifying requirements, validating requirements, and actually then you assess that solution that will come through these requirements with other solutions and recommend the best, right? So this was the requirements analysis. Elicitation was a knowledge area which was eliciting the requirements, right? So eliciting the business needs, solutions, or the requirements, extracting the requirements. So it was all about those techniques that you will use to elicit the requirements, right? And on the other side, you had requirements management and communication, where you are managing the change in the requirements, you are managing the communication with various stakeholders so that they see eye to eye, they are on the same page. And business analysis, planning and monitoring was all about actually planning the entire effort in these four knowledge, these five knowledge areas, and monitoring that effort, tracking that effort, taking all those corrective and preventive actions to ensure that our business analysis activities are performed as per the plan and they are delivering the value. And ultimately, you have underlying competencies which make the business analyst more successful, right? So this was the structure that IIBA BABOK 2.0 had, and all these knowledge areas, they had the task and techniques that need to be applied to understand the structure, policies, operations of an organization, and to recommend those solutions that will best meet those needs, right? So that was the structure of BABOK 2.0. And now with the new definition, the structure of BABOK 3.0 has changed, right? At some places actually the theme has changed, that the theme actually then led to some changes in the techniques, some new techniques and all those kind of things. So this is the structure of the new BABOK, right? Our enterprise analysis, because it was focused on the task and techniques, over here, has become the strategy analysis, right? So you don't, you not only actually identify what is the business need and what are the gaps in the capabilities, you need to look at that from, in the light of an strategy, of a strategy. What is the strategy of the organization? What is the strategic direction of the organization, right? And from that strategy perspective, what are those business needs? Right, so don't look at business needs in isolation. Actually, look at the business needs from the perspective of a strategy. Right, and then you have a requirements analysis and design definition. So this requirements analysis has become requirements analysis and design definition. Actually, if you see in past, requirements analysis purely from the perspective of requirements was bit odd and at times also difficult actually. Many times it makes sense to look at the solution or design the solution at the same time when you are analyzing the requirements. And that's how we work in the organization, right? When we are analyzing the requirements, we also actually see how that requirement can be implemented from design perspective, right? So it has become requirements analysis and design definition, and especially in some of the areas such as process management. Right, your requirements analysis is really a design decision, right? So design and requirements, they have come together. And then you have solution evaluation. When the solution comes, this need to be evaluated, how well that that meets the strategic intent of the organization, right? So you have solution evaluation and elicitation. So solution assessment and validation has become solution evaluation. We need to really evaluate the solution, because now actually we, as part of our definition, we are taking more active role of filling that business need through the solution. So we need to evaluate that solution. And elicitation has become elicitation and collaboration. It is more than those techniques now, right? We need to collaborate with the stakeholders, and we need to actually elicit the requirements with them, through them and with them, right? So elicitation and collaboration, it is not you and me. You give me the requirements and I will recommend the solution. It is actually collaborating throughout the cycle of business analysis and eliciting the requirements. Similarly, requirements management and communication has become requirements life cycle management. Requirements undergo through a life cycle, right? So requirements will start from elicitation. So there are stated requirements, and then you confirm, and then you actually, model those requirements, prioritize those requirements, implement those requirements, all those kind of things. So therefore, the requirements need to be managed throughout the life cycle. It is not only change in the requirement, but their status need to be managed in different status of the requirements, different activities need to be performed. So requirements need to be managed throughout the life cycle of the product, right? And business analysis planning and monitoring. So you need to actually plan for all these activities now, right? So this business analysis planning and monitoring continues over there. Underlying competencies, they are not mentioned as an input to these actually, but underlying competencies are there and they are much more stronger now. So new competencies are added which are relevant for this work. So you see the business analysis BABOK 3, the theme and how that theme actually will take a shape, will support the business analyst, right? So those are the changes that have happened. Okay, yeah. So that's the perspective of that's the BABOK 2 and 3. So this is a little bit insight into demystifying this BABOK 3. Okay. Further, actually, the BABOK 3 has perspectives. So let us understand what is that perspective. Perspectives are something that are used to provide focus to task and techniques in the specific context of that initiative, right? So there are several type of initiatives that are taken in the organization, and the way you will apply the business analysis task and techniques in that initiative could be different, actually will be different in many of those contexts. So these perspectives are basically that type of work or methodology that actually influences the techniques and the task that you will apply on these initiatives, and how will you adapt these techniques and tasks and apply them successfully to deliver that value to the stakeholders, right? So they so most initiatives will engage one or more perspectives, okay? And these perspectives are not mutually exclusive. You could have multiple perspectives in a particular initiative, right? And BABOK 3 has these five perspectives. Agile perspective, so if your project is using agile methodologies, these techniques and tasks of the business analysis body of knowledge, they will be applied in that particular methodology, agile methodology, and they will be different. So agile perspective actually talks about how do you apply or what techniques you can apply in your project if you are using Agile. Okay. Similarly, business intelligence. If you have a project which deals with business intelligence or data analysis, big data, all those kind of things, then actually you apply the business analysis body of knowledge, the task and techniques differently. Information technology, another perspective. Similarly, business architecture. If you're working at a high level architecting the business for a successful outcome, again, the same things are applicable, how they are applied in this context differently. And same is true for process management. If you are working on a BPM project, let's say business process management project, and the way you elicit, the way you, manage the requirements, the way you actually analyze those requirements, all those things are different actually. They need to be executed differently in this context, right? So IIBA has come up with these five perspectives And in each of these perspective, we will see how do we apply these generally acceptable practices of business analysis. How do we adapt our approaches to apply in these perspectives, right? So that's what is the perspective, and our focus today is the first one, Agile. And in coming months, I will be presenting the other perspectives as well, right? So this is our focus, Agile. So now let's look at Agile. What do you mean by Agile actually? What is Agile? So let us look at Agile. And let us look at a very high level what Agile is. This course is, this webinar is not about Agile. So therefore we will not, look at Agile in detail, but we will definitely like to look and understand what Agile means. Okay. So let's look at Agile, so I would like to actually present to you the Agile manifesto. Okay. And Agile manifesto says that we are uncovering better ways of developing software by doing it and helping others to do it. Through this work, we have come to some values. So, Agile started with software development. It was a methodology to develop the software in certain way, right? However, we are seeing now that Agile is being adopted in other areas as well. It is not limited to only software. I have personally seen a couple of initiatives related to business process re-engineering where Agile is applied, right? So it is going in other areas. However, it started with the software, and that's how the manifesto comes actually. But the same thing is applicable out there. So some parts of Agile manifesto is, number one, first part of Agile manifesto is that individuals and interactions are more important over the processes and tools. The focus is not to just follow the processes and tools. The focus is on individuals and interactions and empowering them actually, right? Working software rather over comprehensive documentation. The focus is not on documentation actually, like in waterfall model. The focus is on producing a software that works, and the proof is in the pudding actually. So if the software is working, everything is fine. So, focus on the working software. Customer collaboration over contract negotiation. So collaborate with the customer throughout this process actually of the developing the product. It's not that negotiate the contract, sign that contracts, and then it is actually casted in concrete. You can't change, and it becomes actually all the time any and every change becomes a focus of a point of discussion. So it is all about collaborating with the customer throughout this life cycle of the development, rather than actually contract and following that contract. Also respond to the change as it comes, rather than following a particular plan and implement the product or develop the product following that particular plan. So respond to the change. Change is something which is constant. Change will keep coming. And therefore, when the change comes, acknowledge that change and respond to that change, rather than pushing that particular change or following that plan. Don't respond to the change. So Agile manifesto says, and this is coming from agilemanifesto.org, that is where, while there is a value in the items on the right, we value the item on the left more. That's what Agile says, that it is not that there is no value in these orange colored bullets. There is a value on the right hand side item as well. However, they value the left hand side more. So Agile manifesto never said that you cannot combine actually waterfall and Agile, right? However, this piece often get forgotten actually, while there is a value on the item on the right. I have seen many Agile teams, and they are either on the right hand side or on the left hand side, right? However, the reality is that you need to see what works and be able to take the best thing from both worlds. It is perfectly fine actually to not have a pure Agile practice, right? So that was the Agile manifesto. And Agile always focuses on iterative developments. All Agile methods, they advocate that iterative development, right? Iterations create increments of the technical progress at a steady cadence. The time for every increment is fixed, and every increment will bring a product. The goal of each iteration is to produce a potentially releasable product. Okay, and plans evolve as the iteration progress. So it is not that you are making all the plans in the beginning. The plans keep evolving as the iterations progress. So Agile framework, you know, in Agile framework, you create a product backlog. So you create a backlog of all the requirements. You know, so you have all the requirements and put that those requirements in a list. That list is called product backlog. And you know, as you are, and this product backlog is a list of prioritized requirements. So the highest priority requirements are on the top, and lowest level of priority of requirements is on the bottom. And you know, when you go on the top, that is the high priority requirement, you have fine grain requirements. These requirements are detailed, and as you keep going down, those requirements may be just high level expression of the desire and the functionality that you want to get. Actually, they are not detailed. They are high level functions and features that are listed over there, or high level desire that is listed over there. As you go on the top, the highest level of priorities, you will see that these requirements are fine grain. So this is a prioritized list of requirement that is called a product backlog. And there is a prioritization process to create this priority list of the requirement. Now these requirements are then broken into release backlog. So you plan a release, you know, so there is a process for release planning. Here there is a process for prioritization, and you have a process for release planning, and you have a release backlog. So you see actually what will go in that particular release. And then release is actually delivered through various sprints. Sprints are actually fixed cadence deliveries that will happen. You know, the cadence is fixed, the time duration for each release, each iteration is fixed. So that is called a sprint. So you have a sprint backlog, means the requirements that will go in a particular sprint, and you have a process for sprint planning. Okay. And this sprint is executed between 1 to 4 weeks. In some exceptional cases, I have also seen up to 8 weeks. But in most of them, actually, it is 1 to 4 weeks. Actually, I have not seen too many 1 week iterations. Typically, it is 4 to 2 weeks. I mean, 2 to 4 weeks iterations. So you deliver a working software within 2 to 4 weeks. So therefore, you take those requirements that can be implemented within that time, and you implement those requirements. This duration of the sprint is sacrosanct. So in case you are not able to deliver that product in that time, you can drop some of the requirements. However, the duration is sacrosanct, so need to deliver. And there is a process in this sprint called Scrum meeting. So there is a daily Scrum meeting, which is a stand-up meeting for 10 minutes, where you see what was the plan yesterday, what is the progress on that particular plan, what is the plan for this individual, for today, and are there any blocking issues? You know, so only these questions are asked, and it is a self-organized team. So if someone is not able to complete something, and there is another person who is, let's say, blocked for something, and therefore the person cannot work, that person can actually volunteer and can get some more work for himself or herself, right? So it is a self-organized team. There is no role of a project manager over here. There is a scrum master whose responsibility is to ensure that the data is tracked for planning purposes, so that if you need to drop some of the requirements, you can drop those requirements and even actually meet your deadline of that particular sprint. And the responsibility of a scrum master is to ensure that all the blocking issues are resolved within 24 hours, right? So you have that scrum meeting. And then at the end of this sprint, you have a releasable product or increment, right? And each sprint demo is given. So you see those functionalities, and those are demoed to the stakeholders. they are reviewed. And you know, when stakeholders review those sprints, they might give some feedback in terms of new requirements or something. So those new requirements come and they get added into the product backlog, and there is a process for prioritization, and they will be prioritized. Okay, so that's how the entire software, entire product is developed. There is also a process called sprint retrospective, where you see from the process perspective, you know, how this sprint went and what are those new things that you will do in upcoming sprints. Okay, so that is the framework how the Agile is executed. Okay, and you know, so we will have to do so Agile Perspective is all about doing business analysis work in this environment. Okay, so it is all about doing business analysis work in this environment, and hence therefore we need to understand how we use different tasks and techniques of business analysis knowledge areas in this environment and create a product that creates value to our stakeholders. Okay, so that's what it is. So now let's see the context to the Agile Perspective. Okay, the business analysis part in this Agile framework, right? So Agile Perspective highlights the unique characteristics of business analysis when practiced in the context of Agile environment, right? So what are those unique characteristics of business analysis when you practice that on the Agile field? So before we go there, just a recall. That Agile is about having that flexible mindset. You know, if a new change comes in the requirement, that requirement is actually accepted and it is put in the backlog, right? So it has that flexible mindset. It embodied in a set of values and principles that I have described by the Agile Manifesto. And exhibited by the variety of complementary practices. Scrum is one of them. Agile initiative involves constant change. You know, Agile says that if there is a change in the requirement, don't push that. Change is welcome, actually. Business analyst working on Agile initiatives continuously releases, reassesses the requirements, adapts and adjusts their efforts and the tactics that need to be used for managing those requirements. Business analyst conducts analysis, delivers work product at the last responsible moment, you know, act as late as possible to continuously allow flexibility for changes, you know, so that all the changes can come. So you deliver the approved requirement at the last possible moment. Detailed analysis work is not done ahead of time, but just in time to be effectively utilized by the Agile team. Okay, so this is the context. Now, Agile Business Analyst, you know, Agile Business Analyst ensures that the information is available to the Agile team at the right level of detail, at right level of time. Okay. Business Analyst help Agile team answer these questions actually in the context of BABOK 3. What need we are trying to satisfy? So, you know, because there are not many documents that are available in Agile and the team actually relies on the communication. So therefore, team may ask this question many times in the sprints. What need we are trying to satisfy? And business analyst can answer that question effectively. Is the need worth satisfying? You know, so again, business analysts know that what is the business case, why it is important. Should we deliver something to satisfy that need? You know, so when there is a need, something should we deliver? What is that solution? You know, what is the right thing to do to deliver that particular need? Business analysis work is performed therefore continuously throughout an Agile initiative and relies heavily on interpersonal skills like communication skills, facilitation skills, coaching, negotiations. So all those underlying competencies need to be applied, need to be demonstrated. An Agile business analysis may be performed by many people, any role actually. It could be a product manager, it could be a product owner, it could be a business analyst or any other team member, you know. So business analyst need not have a title of business analyst, right? It can be performed by anyone. Business analysts help the team identify modifications in assumptions and other project variations that can come throughout this life cycle.
Okay.
So typical Agile BA activities. Okay. So any team member who is with a BA skills on the Agile project can perform these activities, and those activities are work with the product owner. Sometimes business analyst could also play a role of a product owner, and work with the team on defining the user roles and personas. Personas means defining those stakeholders. What is the personality of that that stakeholder? What is the desire of that stakeholder? What is the characteristics of that stakeholder? So define the role or personas of the stakeholder. Define the user stories, which capture the user requirements, and their acceptance test. Every user story need to have acceptance test. So define that. Helping the product owner prioritize and manage the product backlog. Facilitating user story workshops, identifying themes for the release, contributing to the release and iteration planning, identifying and estimating the business analysis task. Also groom the product backlog for upcoming iterations, right? Provide those needed details to get stories ready for the development. Elicit new stories. Requirements analysis and modeling so that everyone understands those requirements. So those are the typical activities that BAs need to do, and they need to perform actually in a limited time that is available. So there are some major assumptions in Agile, and they are important for ensuring that Agile is successful, right? And those assumptions are, and we need to understand as business analysts to be very effective in this. Number one is change in requirements are welcome, even late in the development, because the assumption is that these requirements don't go away even if you push them away, right? Requirements will come, and if they come later, they will require more resources to implement, right? So requirements changes are welcome at any stage. The business problems can be reduced to a set of needs. So this is another assumption, that you can actually reduce the business problem to a set of needs that can be met using some combination of technology or business processes. Agile initiatives have fully engaged customers. Your customers need to get engaged in this entire process. And also the employees or SMEs are empowered. There is no command and control. They are empowered with complete buy-in into Agile approach. And ideally, the team membership is constant. It means that members do not change continuously or move into other teams. The team actually remains together. There is a preference for multidisciplinary and co-located teams. It is not that Agile cannot work in distributed teams, but it best works when the team is co-located, and they often time they sit actually in a big room without any cubicles or nothing. They sit together. Team members may perform more than one role within the team. Team member have a mindset for continuous improvement and successful value delivery. Agile teams are empowered and self-organizing. So these are the assumptions that must hold true on the Agile projects. And there are many Agile approaches. Scrum is very well known, but other than Scrum, there are many Agile approaches, and many of them are known actually. So Scrum, you have SAFe, which is a scalable Agile framework. Okay, so you have SAFe, you have XP, which is extreme programming, you have TDD, test-driven development, or FDD, feature-driven development, you have Kanban, you have crystal clear. Crystal means solid business need, and clear is related to the rigor. So crystal clear is another methodology. You have EBO, which is evolutionary project management. You have DSDM, disciplined agile delivery. And you have DAD, DAD, which is, DAD is disciplined agile delivery. DSDM is a dynamic system development method. So there are many approaches to the agile, And you know, based on the initiative that you have, actually, business analysts need to know at a high level what these approaches are and when it is appropriate to apply these approaches. And BABOK perspective actually deals into this. So you are much more knowledgeable on this. So now let's understand more about business analysis in this environment, right? So what is that agile perspective? So we understood the business analysis, we understood the agile, and now let's put them together and see how our agile perspective will look like. Okay. So there are 10 things to remember while doing the business analysis work in agile, right? Keep that in mind. That's very important for us to then decide what is appropriate for that project. The first one is deliver quick business value, right? Okay, Rashikar is saying, is the audio on mute? No, Rashikar, audio is not on mute. I hope you people are able to hear. Can you please raise your hands? All those people who are able to hear, can you please raise the hands? Am I audible? Yeah. Thank you so much. So I'm audible. Please check your audio at your end if you're not able to hear me. Let me type this message quickly to everyone. Okay, thank you for your patience while I was typing this message. So there are 10 points to remember while doing that business analysis work on agile projects, right? One is deliver quick business value. Every sprint that we do, every requirement that we prioritize must deliver that business value. So deliver quick business value. Second one, have the product vision. What is that we are trying to do? In Agile, actually, when you are implementing the software in 1 to 4 weeks, oftentimes it is very easy for us to lose that vision, the big vision. So therefore, actually, business analysts need to have that complete vision in mind, product vision. Need to focus on planning, you know, what thing will go first, how it will go, how it will be delivered. A small scope, need to consider a very small scope for this. Time boxed development cycle, which are called sprints, right? So time boxed development cycle, and time is sacrosanct, and therefore our business analysis work also need to get completed in this sprint. Prioritize the requirement, because our backlog is always prioritized. So prioritize those requirements. Fast failure means, you know, if there is a risk in the requirement, those requirements need to be taken for implementation upfront so that we can identify those critical issues, you know, and if we need to find those things that are not working early enough. Barely sufficient. So, you know, select all those requirements that can be implemented in that sprint, right? And therefore, you know, think of something that is the minimum viable product, you know, so barely sufficient product functionalities. Visualize that result. Give the demo to everyone. Visualize that result. What has been done. And have a sustainable pace. Ensure that the entire product can be developed using these sprints. So have that sustainable pace, actually. So these are 10 very important points that we must remember as business analysts on the Agile project. So how can we apply the BABOK 3 in this context? So let us go to the application part of BABOK 3 task and techniques. Yeah, so that's what we are going to do in this particular section. So I will cover actually the task in every knowledge area in BABOK 3. and the techniques that can be applied in a particular knowledge area. So our first knowledge area is business analysis, planning and monitoring. It means plan the activities that will be the task that will be performed in all these five knowledge areas. So plan all those tasks that they will be performed, who will perform that task, what techniques will be used, what when they will be performed, all those kind of things that we are planning. So our tasks are, one, plan business analysis approach, how the business analysis will be performed in the project that you are executing, right? So consider that methodology of Agile, consider all those practices of Agile that I displayed in many bubbles in one of the diagrams, right? Because they have unique characteristics, and we need to plan our business analysis effort based on that actually, right? Plan for that stakeholder engagement. As we said, stakeholder engagement is extremely important for Agile projects, and therefore we need to plan actually how do we engage with these stakeholders. Plan business analysis governance is not so much used in Agile perspective. Governance is basically who will control, who will actually provide the guidance or governance on how the work need to be done. Plan business analysis information management system, how the information will be shared, and this is again a very important part of Agile perspective, because in Agile environment the information is oftentimes actually shared informally. It is shared through scrum meetings and verbal. So plan that in information management, identify business analysis performance improvements, and this is part of every sprint, and therefore business analyst need to play a critical role in retrospectives and the demos that are happening for every sprint, right? So these are the five tasks in business analysis, planning and monitoring, and four of them are very relevant, and you know, this some quality time need to be spent while planning these particular tasks. So the techniques that you can use in this, and there are many techniques, and some of them are new techniques. So those new techniques, they will get repeated in other knowledge areas as well. And I have not written new everywhere. I will write the new one. So one technique which has been added in BABOK 3 is backlog management. Backlog is the backbone of Agile development, right? So this backlog needs to be managed. And that is one technique that is important. Also, a new technique has come, which is collaborative games. So, you know, it is a fun part of involving your audience, and a collaborative game is a new technique which has come. Estimation, need to estimate the work, estimate the story points, metrics and key performance indicators. How will you see actually that the project is being executed right, or the business analysis work is being performed effectively? So what are those metrics and what are those KPIs that need to be managed to determine the success of your projects? Mind mapping. Mind mapping is another new technique, a good technique, which is basically a visual graphical representation of putting things together, identifying and managing the relationship with various activities. So mind mapping. Prioritization. Very important technique when you are planning for Agile projects, right? Prioritization. Also scope modeling, so that people can see the big picture and see what is in scope, not in scope, and what is going in every release or every sprint. And stakeholder management. So stakeholder list, stakeholder map, stakeholder personas. So understanding those stakeholders, user stories, right? Workshop to create the requirements, user stories. Other techniques are lightweight documentation, must have, should have, could have, won't have. That is the prioritization techniques. Personas, you know, as part of understanding or analyzing your stakeholders. Relative estimation. Agile uses relative estimation quite often. So you actually estimate in story points. So relative estimation is another technique that is listed in BABOK. And it was also listed actually in the Agile extension book that BABOK extension to Agile that IIBA had, and you have a retrospective, So this is your business analysis, planning and monitoring, and you have so many techniques. Unfortunately, we don't have time to go over these techniques, and these techniques do require understanding how do we apply these techniques on agile projects. But the good thing is that so many techniques are available to you, and when you go through the BABOK and understand them, you will understand when to apply this technique and how to apply this technique to really deliver the value to our stakeholders. Okay. The next one is elicitation and collaboration, which has five tasks: prepare for elicitation, conduct elicitation, and confirm the elicitation results. All right. And communicate business analysis information. Again, very, very important actually. All of them are important, but communication I cannot overemphasize for agile projects. Extremely important, right? Also manage stakeholder collaboration. Your stakeholders need to collaborate, so manage that collaboration throughout. So all the tasks are important tasks, and they are applicable in the agile perspective. And there are many techniques that are available for you to elicit the requirement and ensure that collaboration, right? One is acceptance and evaluation criteria definition, a very good technique for eliciting as well as collaborating. Backlog management, brainstorming, collaborative games, again over here. Concept modeling, this is a new technique. You model that concept, you actually show that concept using the model, so that you have a clear understanding of everyone. Interface analysis, mind mapping, non-functional requirements analysis, process modeling, prototyping, reviews, scope modeling, all those are elicitation and collaboration techniques, right? And then you have a stakeholder list, map, and personas, use cases, scenarios, user stories, workshops. So again, lot of techniques over here. Requirements lifecycle management has those five tasks. So first one is trace the requirements, and again a very important value add that business analyst can bring to trace the requirements to the need and to the solution components. Maintain those requirements. Okay. Prioritize the requirements. Assess the requirements. Change. Make an assessment whenever the change is coming. And approval of those requirements. So approval of the requirement happens, it does not happen over here actually. The requirements go in the backlog, and only the prioritization is a mechanism of approving. However, that also happens. So those things, and again you have techniques to manage this: acceptance and evaluation criteria, backlog management, again collaborative games, again prioritization, reviews, workshop, a new technique called Kano analysis. And Kano model is a very good model actually. This describes what type of requirements will excite the stakeholders, what type of requirements will be treated as a performance factor. So more and more of those kind of requirements that you give, more satisfied your stakeholders will be, and what type of requirements, if they are absent, then your stakeholder will be dissatisfied. But having all those requirements does not lead to the satisfaction. But if you don't have any of those requirements, the stakeholders will be very dissatisfied. Let's say you go in a training and you are not given the writing pad and a pencil, the small pad and pencil that is given, that is not there. You will be very unhappy, very dissatisfied, because you expected that. However, if you are given that pencil and pad, it doesn't mean that you will be very happy. Right, so Kano provides a classification of these type of requirements, which you can use very effectively for eliciting. Right, you have Maslow analysis for prioritization, story decomposition, story mapping. Right, so again requirements over here, and then you have a strategy analysis. So a strategy analysis has four tasks. First one, in analyze the current state, what is the current state of the organization, and define the future state, define your to be state, make an assessment of the risk, and define that change strategy. Again, all four of them are applicable for the agile perspective. And there are techniques, again, backlog management, brainstorming, business capability analysis, which is a new technique, collaborative games, concept modeling, which is another new techniques, metrics and key performance indicators, scope modeling and workshop. Here you have Kano analysis, personas, purpose alignment model, which is a new technique. Real option is another new technique, and value stream analysis is another new technique. So there are a lot of new techniques. And requirements analysis and design definition, specify and model the requirements, right? Need to be done very quickly. So we need to actually get all those tools and techniques that can help you specify and model the requirements quickly, verify those requirements, validate the requirements, define the requirement architecture, define the design options, analyze potential value and recommended solution. So there are six tasks in this particular knowledge area, and there are a lot of techniques in this, as in the previous one also, right? Requirements analysis and design definition has a lot of techniques, you know, and all these techniques can be used in Agile Perspective. By the way, there are more techniques. I'm showing only those techniques which are more relevant in Agile Perspective. Okay, so there are a lot of techniques over here. And solution evaluation again has five tasks: measure the solution performance, analyze performance measures, assess solution limitations. You know, very, very important techniques for your sprint, task for the sprints. Then you have assess enterprise limitation. This is unique value that business analyst can bring. What are the limitations that are there? Recommend actions to increase the solution value. Another a good one that business analyst can add value to the Agile projects. Currently, actually, our Agile projects, most of them I have seen that they actually lack focus on these areas, and very important areas that business analysts can play an important role. And again, there are a lot of techniques over here as well: acceptance evaluation criteria, business capability analysis, KPI analysis, non-functional requirements, process analysis, prototyping, reviews, stakeholders, user stories, scenarios, workshops, personas, value stream analysis. So a lot of analysis from evaluating the solution perspective. Okay, so all these tasks and techniques, they are available to you to be very successful in on the projects that has the Agile methodology. And there are underlying competencies, and especially in underlying competencies, these are the few ones that I have found very relevant and more useful over here, like communication and collaboration, very important for Agile projects. Patience and tolerance, right? This is a new underlying competency that has come, and very important for Agile projects. Flexibility and adaptability, that is another one that has come in BABOK 3. Very important. Ability to handle change, that is another new one that has come, and again very important. Ability to recognize business value, that is another underlying competency which is new. And similarly, continuous improvement, that is also a new underlying competency. So these underlying competencies, they are very useful in our Agile perspective. So that was the Agile perspective, the BABOK 3, how it is different from BABOK 2, and what are those changes in BABOK 3 versus BABOK 2, the perspective, and we understood the Agile little bit, and we also understood the, you know, the how business analyst role changes in Agile projects, and how can you, what can you apply from BABOK 3, and how you can, you know, not how actually, what are those tasks and techniques that can be applied on BABOK 3. This is a big area actually. We have complete full 2 days course on this called Mastering Business Analysis in Agile. You know, so it was really not possible for me to go deeper into it, though my personality suggests that I should explain a little bit more deep. So I'm sure you will have lot many questions. And if you have those questions, please write to me. I have the email address and or phone number over here. So reach out to me, you know, and if you want to get into the detail of this subject, actually, please feel free to look at our website or the course or whatever it is. Yeah, so this was it. Let me take the questions now. So I have some questions and I will go through these questions. Okay, so I have a question over here. Clarify whether solutioning be part of the technical analysis rather than business analysis, or does this mean should business analyst involve in technical team solutioning? No, business analyst actually don't involve with the technical team solutioning, but now business analyst actually have to be involved in design decisions. You know, what are the components of the solutions, how the solution will be implemented actually. So design part is part of business analysis. So our requirements analysis has become requirements analysis and design decisions. You know, so design need to be done. Okay, next one. What is the difference between Kanban and Scrum? I noticed that these are used interchangeably. Organized. So Scrum is a daily stand-up meeting. Kanban is a different process altogether. It will take a little bit time for me to explain that in detail. So I will recommend that if you can write to me actually separately, I can do that for you, or just Google Kanban and you will understand very clearly, because I'm sure you know about the Scrum and I have explained the Scrum, that is the stand-up meeting. Kanban is different thing. Other question is the time only factor involved in defining the sprint? No, Ashok, the most important factor is the value. Which requirements will create more value, and the time, which is a sprint, is your constraint. So then you will see actually what are the best stories that will maximize your value of this particular release. So sprint time is only the constraint. Time is only constraint. It is the value that the business analyst need to look for. The other one is Moscow is typically used for requirements prioritization. How do we apply it in BAPM knowledge area? The Moscow analysis in BAPM, as a business analyst, when you work on the agile projects, you have so many things to do and you are always constrained with the time, because you know the sprint time is very less, and therefore you need to do the business analysis work in that time. And when you are constrained with that time, you will have to also prioritize your activities. And that's why actually you have the Moscow analysis in BAPM. You will see actually what are those activities that you must have, what are those activities that should have, could have, or won't have from the business analysis perspective, because you have the constraint, you cannot do everything, right? So that's how Moscow analysis is very relevant in BAPM. What costing method practiced for the agile projects? Agile oftentimes actually, so rather than costing, I will say estimation. Agile oftentimes actually has story points. So you have relative, cost of the story, and that is used as a means of planning. So basically you see, what are the story points of a story. And that is a very popular and good method actually that is used in Agile. Does an Agile BA creates model as part of specifying and modeling the requirement task? If yes, will it be specific to a user story or a feature? Well, it depends, Jaydev, on what type of project that you are executing. Again, the theme is you cannot do those models which are time consuming, because again, you may have that constraint of the time, so you may not be able to do it. However, models are sometimes necessary. For example, if you are working on a process initiative, now process requirements are very, very important, very difficult to describe without you modeling actually. So therefore, even in agile projects, when you're working on the processes, you need to model the processes. Okay. Also, you use the throwaway models more rather than you using using the evolutionary models, which take a lot more time. So you focus on the time, select those models which need to be used to elicit the requirements or to analyze the requirements, to confirm the requirements. Right, so you need to be very judicious and still use those things for the work that you are doing. In agile project, how the changes are tracked, like change control board? No, there is no change control board in agile. In agile methodology, changes are always welcome. So you have the change and the changes go and sit on your product backlog. And you have that all the time prioritized list of the product backlog. And then when the sprint is planned, those requirements which are of high value, they will go in your sprint. So changes always come. They are always welcome. And they will come and sit in the product backlog. So there is no change control board per se. There is a process called sprint planning, and in which you will consider all the requirements, including these change requests, and you will take whatever creates value. How can solution evaluation be done in Agile? This can be done in every sprint. Yes, you know, this will be done in every sprint actually. You will evaluate the solution and how well the solution meets the needs of your stakeholder, how the values are created to your stakeholder. So it will be done in every sprint. Is there a certification on Agile specific BAs? No, there is no Agile specific BA certification. We have worked with Auburn University and they have just approved the certificate actually. So we need to launch that certificate. So this will be the certified Agile BA. So Jaydev, there will be a certificate that Valicate will be offering through Auburn University of US. If a customer wants to squeeze new requirements inside a sprint 1 or 2 days before the sprint release, how do you handle it? Push it back the deadline or push the requirements to the next sprint? Deepa, one of the principle of Agile is that your sprints are sacrosanct. You don't take any change request in the sprint. No new requirement in the sprint can come. You can drop a requirement from the sprint in case you are not able to deliver, for example, all the requirements in the sprint in that time, then you know, time is sacrosanct. So you cannot actually delay your sprint, but you can drop some of the requirements. Okay, so requirements coming in a sprint, no way. They will not come. They will always go and sit in the product backlog. Is it required to make sure that all the use cases are captured as part of the Scrum change brief? Sometimes testers come back saying, can you add a generic point as well, browser, screen size, and all those kind of things? No, Ritika, not all the use cases need to be captured upfront. Remember, the theme is collaboration. Theme is continuous involvement. Theme is communication. So if you see actually that, you know, there is a lack of clarity on any of the points, right? You will come up at the use case that time, you know, so you use those techniques whenever you see that there is an appropriate need for that technique. Actually, your objective is to ensure that you know, the value is created to the customer, and you know, the product development is supported by your effort. Does a BA involve in testing as part of the Agile framework? Could involve in testing actually. So you so BAs need to anyway write the acceptance test plan. And in Agile, actually, all the user stories, they need to have the acceptance test plan. And one of the part, whether we are BA or someone else is performing that task of a BA, that person will have to write the acceptance test plan. Baselining of requirements will not be a BA activity in Agile perspective. Yes, Ashok, you are right. Actually, there is no activity called baselining of requirements in Agile. So forget about Agile perspective. It is not there in Agile, and therefore it will not be there in Agile perspective also, actually. That baselining doesn't happen because it is always actually in the product backlog. So you don't have a baseline where the change need to be approved. There is no change approval mechanism. All the requirements will come in and sit in the product backlog. They don't require any approval, so hence it is not there. Is the feedback from previous sprint always included in the next sprint? So first of all, feedback is a very, very important mechanism and good strong point of Agile. So feedback need to be taken, and then actually business analysts play an important role in evaluating and recommending what can be included in the next sprint so that it will add value to your stakeholders. So therefore, this need to be included, and the stakeholders also include your development team. So if something actually is valuable for them, you need to recommend that it should be included. Does that mean each sprint need to include a Slack for development change from the previous sprint? No, development change, Deepa, is a new requirement. So development change, it will come and again sit in the product backlog. And then you will prioritize that actually as part of other requirements over other requirements. So that prioritization need to happen. Sometimes Kanban approach, BA is asked to do UAT to meet the monthly change count. Is it common? Kritika, this is again a part of the acceptance, the product acceptance. So when Kanban approach is there, UAT, user acceptance test, what is user acceptance test? User acceptance test actually ensures that the value that the user was expecting, that value is delivered. And value delivery is part of BA activities. So many times actually BAs will perform that activity, or anyone who is performing that activity is actually performing the BA task, be it Kanban or any other approach. Chidambaram asks, can we get the slide decks? Yes, Chidambaram, by all means, actually. And as I said, we will also put this on the YouTube. So you will definitely get this video on the YouTube, right? If the changes are continuous and not documented at a high level, how the accountability is managed for the quality, cost, time, and issue. So this is, Arun, this is the difference in the management philosophy. Here actually in Agile, the teams are self-organized. And one of the theme is that if the team can pick a task and team hold themselves accountable for the timelines for that particular task, from that list of approved prioritized requirements and the projects that need to be done. So they are accountable for the quality, they are accountable for their time, and everything is managed through a daily stand-up meeting. So you have the daily stand-up meeting called Scrum. And in that Scrum meeting, which is a 10 minutes meeting, it will be managed through that actually. So this is a different, entirely different philosophy of management actually. The accountability is with the team. Could you please show back the slide again where the differences between BABOK 2 and 3 was explained? I just needed to take a look again. Sure, Nishant, I will show after these questions. Does Scrum meeting involve only technical team developers or entire team include? So, you know, including all BA, PM, UI designer, you know, sys architects, etc. Actually, you know, diversity is one of the principle that I have explained in those 10 points. It is preferable that all the teams are involved and they are co-located. That is the preference actually. So diversity is very important, Deepa. Involve as many people in your stand-up meeting as possible, all the roles actually, you know, all need to be there. How do we track the changes when the requirements will come and sit on the backlog? How to backtrack the old requirement? So Shrijit, this backlog, actually the backlog requirements are prioritized and there is a process for prioritizing those requirements, and that happens actually continuously. So if your sprint is, let's say, 4 weeks sprint, sometimes it happens actually in that 4 week time, two times or three times. So when the requirements come, that list is reviewed periodically, and there is a process for prioritizing the requirements relative to each other. And ultimately, before the next sprint starts, you have a prioritized list of requirements. You know, so that happens, that is part of, sometimes it happens as part of sprint planning. Sometimes it happens in some of the organization, you know, multiple times. So it depends on which project, what product that you are developing. And based on that, and again, BA can play an important role. You can learn from the sprints and you can suggest actually change in this philosophy if you want to express any change. Common tools used for managing changes in the requirement. Well, there are many tools, Kritika, so I will not like to name any particular tool over here. There are agile specific tools and there are many of them actually that you can use. What kind of documentation will have to be prepared by the BA for each sprint? Do we own and maintain any documents? Actually, Sahai, the document is not the focus of Agile. In Agile, actually, sometimes the only document that you create is code. No documentation is created. So Agile methodology relies on more verbal information, more collaboration, more of working with the team. And therefore, actually, business analysts have another important role to play. You need to really apply thinking and see what documents are must to create. You know, and create those documents. Who would be an ideal SME? A person from the client organization, PM, a vendor company? Is it necessary that they know all the requirements at a high level or vision? What is the role or contribution? Deepa, again, you know, you need to see what is the situation and who that person could qualify to be an SME for that particular situation, right? And you need to actually identify that subject matter expert. Doesn't matter from where that expert comes. Don't worry about it. You know, collaboration is the name of the game in Agile. So get everyone involved: customer, your supplier, you know, anyone. However, you need to also see the sensitivity of it. Some of the projects you have the regulatory compliances. Some of the projects you have legal binding with your customers. So you need to be sensitive. However, you know, get the subject matter experts whenever you have a need. Okay, so there are a lot more questions, but in the interest of time, what I will request that if you have any further question, my email ID is still on the screen. Please feel free to send the email. I will love to actually answer your questions. Yeah, so please feel free. Thank you very much for your participation. Really, I thoroughly enjoyed this discussion. And this is a big topic. I hope I could have done better. Actually, if the time was there, I could have gone a little bit more deeper into all these techniques and how you can apply, probably some other time actually, right? Thank you very much for your participation. Appreciate you joining. Have a great evening.